Welcome to the Salvation Army Leeds Central Corps on this Good Friday morning service on in 2020. Very, very different from what we normally observe. We're all at home, we're watching online. And so things are very, very different, but the story is still that beautiful story of old. Very early in the morning, the chief priests with the elders, the teachers of the law, and the whole Sanhedrin reached a decision. They bound Jesus, led him away, and turned him over to Pilate. "Are you the king of the Jews?" asked Pilate. "Yes, it is as you say," Jesus replied. The chief priests accused him of many things, so again Pilate asked him, "Aren't you going to answer? See how many things they are accusing you of." But Jesus still made no reply, and Pilate was amazed. Now, it was the custom at the feast to release a prisoner whom the people requested. A man called Barabbas was in prison with the insurrectionists who had committed murder in the uprising. The crowd came up and asked Pilate to do for them what he usually did. "Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?" asked Pilate. Knowing it was out of envy that the chief priests had handed Jesus over to him, but the chief priests had stirred up the crowd to have Pilate release Barabbas instead. "What shall I do then with the one you call the king of the Jews?" Pilate asked them. "Crucify him," they shouted. "Why? What crime has he committed?" asked Pilate. But they shouted all the louder, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Wanting to satisfy the crowd, Pilate released Barabbas to them. He had Jesus flogged and handed him over to be crucified. As Jesus was condemned to death on the cross, so he was led forth for scourging. They stretched his body rigid upon a frame and whipped and whipped and whipped him again with leather thongs studded with sharpened lead, iron and bone. It ripped his back to pieces. The soldiers made him a crown of thorns and gave him a reed for a scepter and an old purple cloak for a robe. And then they mocked him and jeered him. They then made their way to Golgotha, and as they went, they continued lashing and goading Jesus until he was so weak he could carry his cross no further. At the place of crucifixion, the cross was laid flat on the ground and the criminal placed on top of it. As Jesus was stretched upon the cross, so nails were driven through his hands and his feet. Then, in a moment of searing agony, the cross was lifted up and rammed into its socket. And Jesus said, "When I am lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men to myself." Let's sing together the great hymn, "When I Survey the Wondrous Cross."
Thank you. Mark chapter 15, verses 16 to 20. The soldiers led Jesus away into the palace and called together the whole company of soldiers. They put a purple robe on him, then twisted together a crown of thorns and set it on him. And they began to call out to him, "Hail, King of the Jews." Again and again they struck him on the head with a staff and spat on him. Falling on their knees, they paid homage to him. And when they had mocked him, they took off the purple robe and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him. If we had been Jews, would we have spoken out for him when the Sanhedrin accused him of blasphemy? If we had been Gentiles, would we have defended him when the Romans condemned him to death? If we had been disciples, would we have stayed with him when the crowd became a crucifying mob? Or would we have been like Peter, who followed him and loved him, and denied him three times before the dawn? And the Christ who was crucified there once said, "As you have done it to the least of these my brothers, you have done it unto me."
So the songs piece I've chosen to go with today's service on Good Friday is We Saw Love by Andrew Blythe. We've used this quite a lot of times over the last few years. It is a beautiful piece of music. And before you listen to it, I just want to share some words from Scripture which talk about the love displayed on the cross. So John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life." Romans 5 verse 8, "But God demonstrates his own love for us in this, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us."
He was. a man called Simon, who was from Cyrene, was coming in from the country just then, and they forced him to carry Jesus' cross. And they brought Jesus to a place called Golgotha, which is Skull Hill. They offered him wine drugged with myrrh, but he refused it. Then they nailed him to the cross. They gambled for his clothes, throwing a dice to decide who would get them. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when the crucifixion took place. A signboard was fastened to the cross above Jesus' head, announcing the charge against him. It read, "The King of the Jews." Two criminals were crucified with him, their crosses on either side of his. And the people passing by shouted abuse, shaking their heads and saying, "Hey, look at you now," they yelled at him. "You can destroy the temple in 3 days, can you? Well, come down from the cross and save yourself." The leading chief priests and teachers of the law also mocked Jesus. "He saved others," they scoffed, "but he can't save himself. Let this Messiah, this King of Israel, come down from the cross that we can see it and believe him." Even the two criminals who were crucified with Jesus ridiculed him. As nations rise in war, as governments oppress the poor, as passive people turn and look aside in silence, we crucify. Again, we crucify as indifference forms the patterns of our lives, as hungry children cry for food, as widows mourn alone in rooms, we crucify. Again, we crucify. Jesus said, "Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friend."
for the Bible reading, Mark 15, verses 33 to 39. At noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At 3 p.m, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, my God, why have you forsaken me? When some of those standing near heard this, they said, listen, he's calling Elijah. Someone ran, filled a sponge with wine vinegar, put it on a staff, and offered it to Jesus to drink. Now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes down to take him down, he said. With a loud cry, Jesus breathed his last. The curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And when the centurion who stood there in front of Jesus saw how he died, he said, surely this is the Son of God. Amen. I think of the nails that crucified my Lord. They were made of iron, but more, they were made of hatred, prejudice, and greed. And I wonder, what part of myself is found in the shadow of that mob that stretched down through history? What part of myself creates nails in other forms that wound my brother and my Lord? In the act of death, he absorbs our sins. In love, he forgives our failures. In the act of resurrection, he gives the promise of acceptance, the assurance of forgiveness, the affirmation of eternal life. Through our love, I am made whole. Through your death, I have found new life. You are my shield, my redeemer, and my hope. And the Christ who was crucified said upon the cross, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing. Amen.
This morning, our band had intended to play some newly published pre-meeting music, an arrangement of the Old Rugged Cross. It's played this morning by a Salvationist Publishing and Supplies ensemble. Although not a Salvation Army composition, this song has long been associated particularly with the Army. Many years ago, as a 16-year-old selling the Salvation Army newspapers in pubs and clubs in the city of Hull, most weeks, one club would invite me to sing. The organist would accompany as I sang the Old Rugged Cross. The noise and hubbub died away, and it seemed as if there was some recognition of the precious truth behind the words, reminding us of the sacrifice of Jesus, laying aside his claim to heavenly glory, and more than that, sacrificing his very life to pay the price of our sin and self-will. Worshipping at the cross today, we're challenged with these words to hold the cross dear, to share in the loving sacrifice of Jesus, and hold the message of the cross up before the world of today.
Thank you.
noticed at all, but the news reporters seem to have stopped using the word unprecedented. I think it came to a head on one of those evening reports from Downing Street in the early days of COVID-19, and I counted multiple uses of that word, so many that I think I asked if there were other words for unprecedented. And of course there are. Unparalleled, extraordinary, unique, exceptional, and incomparable, for instance. Today, on this Good Friday of 2020, when our city, our nation, our world is in a lockdown, when transport has come to a halt, when businesses have stopped and our lives have ceased from their busy routines, we are afforded time and space to be still for a moment or two and given an opportunity to consider another Friday, another unprecedented moment, another day of unparalleled death, when the sickness and disease of our souls were soaked in the grace, mercy, kindness, and love of our Saviour Jesus Christ as he hung upon the cross outside the city walls of Jerusalem. It was the Jewish Passover, a celebration of another day when the angel of death passed over this world and culled humanity, and a recall of how by the blood of the sacrificial lamb they had been saved. I want to encourage you this morning to allow the Spirit of God to open your eyes of faith as you allow the events of that day to help us come to terms with the whereabouts of God in this current pandemic. For the cross tells us that God knows pain and death. Isaiah 53 verses 4 and 5 says this: "Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering, yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed." What is your image of God? Someone once said to Jeff Lucas, "I don't believe in God." And Jeff Lucas replied, "Tell me what sort of God you don't believe in, because I probably don't believe in that sort of a God either." For many people, their image of God is that of a puppet master, a draconian force who operates in some kind of nether region beyond our world with no concept or understanding of what human life is all about. He seems to be an invisible deity, one could almost say an absent deity, who may have created our world but actually wants nothing to do with it. Paul writes in his letter to the Colossians that Jesus is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. To put it plainly, that means that this man upon the cross that we remember on this day was none other than God. The baby in the manger, the boy who grew up in Nazareth and learned a carpenter's trade, the man who became a carpenter who cared for his stepbrothers and stepsisters and his mother, the rabbi who became a preacher, teacher, healer, and prophet, the man who wept at his friend's grave, the missionary who was arrested, beaten, tried, punished with a whip of sharpened bones, the criminal upon the cross, despised, forsaken, stricken. That was none other than God himself. Yes, the Creator visited his creation, and his creation crucified him. Does that describe a God who is distant, remote, uncaring, unknowing of what humanity is all about? But this is our God. This is our God whom we worship, a crucified and crowned Saviour, Redeemer, Lord and friend, a God who knows pain, a God who understands death and walks through our times of deprivation and loss with us because of the cross. But if the cross reveals that we have a God who knows pain and death, surely it also reveals the deadly nature of sin. I don't know if you've ever stopped to consider why it was expedient for Christ to be crucified upon the cross. Why did he die? Several very clever people through the ages have taken time to think this through at very deep levels. Fortunately for us, they've written their responses down for us also to consider in depth. And there are many ideas that have been developed over the past 2,000 years to answer that question, why did Jesus die? And collectively, they're called the theories of the atonement. But I like what C.S. Lewis very succinctly says. He says this: the central Christian belief is that Christ's death has somehow put us right with God and given us a fresh start. Theories as to how it did this are another matter. A good many different theories have been held as to how it works. What all Christians are agreed on is that it does work. We are told that Christ was killed for us, that his death has washed out our sins, and that by dying, he disabled death itself. That is the formula. That is Christianity. That is what has to be believed. Any theories we build up as to how Christ's death did all this are, in my view, he says, quite secondary. Christ was killed for us. Why? Because we were not good enough to pay a price for our sins. His death has washed out our sins. How? I don't know. I just know that it has. By dying, he disabled death itself. What? Death itself is disabled? So the cross not only reveals the deadly nature of sin, not only reveals who our God is, but it reveals to us that death is not the final word in life. One of the attitudes we must be careful not to be drawn into during this pandemic is the attitude in our Western world that is fearful of death. Don't get me wrong or misquote me. The deaths worldwide through coronavirus or related underlying health matters are horrendous. As I write, the total is almost 73,000, and that figure is going to increase sharply over the next few weeks. And it's right that we take as many precautions as possible, but we cannot and we must not, as followers of Christ, be led by fear, and certainly not fear of death itself. When Christ died upon the cross, his final words were, "It is finished." It was not a whimper, it was not a whisper, but a shout of triumph. One of those theories of the atonement is entitled Christus Victor, and it takes its name and thought from the conquering heroes of ancient wars who would march through the cities and towns in a victory parade, dragging behind them their conquered, vanquished hosts. Jesus' work was to rescue us from our sins. Jesus' mission to rescue us from death was over, and as the victor over death, he parades that imposter behind him in his victory parade. Just a couple of weeks ago, Chip Yorn, the Christian writer, wrote in one of his Facebook blogs, "I should admit that I'm a believer who's convinced that the great sweeping narrative of the Bible, from the creation of the world through the corruption of human selfishness, God's choice of a people to whom he reveals himself, the coming of Jesus, the birth of the church to the consummation of all things in that great new creation, is the only story that makes sense of life and death. And without a big story that makes sense of things, it isn't just our death that's a puzzle. Life itself doesn't have any ultimate meaning." I don't know if you've ever been to the village of Iam in Derbyshire. During the 17th century plague that ravaged Europe, this village did something quite noble. When the plague was discovered for the first time in their village, every villager chose to isolate themselves from the surrounding villages. They erected a wall to keep themselves in and others out. They received their food and their drink, left by their neighbouring villages and paid for by leaving the food and the money in the food on top of the wall, the money in a well of water and vinegar, so that the disease was cleansed from the coins. Out of a village of 350 people, only 90 survived. But not one person died in the neighbouring villages. What inspired them to this selfless act? In a joint sermon, two clergymen, William Mompesson and Thomas Stanley, pointed to the cross, the sacrifice of Jesus, his victory over death, and urged them to follow his example and lay down their lives for others. Death, for them, did not hold them in fear. Can we not similarly look death itself in the face, confident that Christ has overcome through his own death upon the cross? This Good Friday is certainly different from the norm, just as life itself is different from the norm. But it can be different for you in a most remarkable way. Look at the cross and reflect upon it. Ask yourself why it was that Jesus chose to die there. Look at what we have gained through his loss. Take heart, have courage, do not fear. And be sure this day that Jesus defeated even death itself, and place your faith in him, especially in these troubled days. As C.S. Lewis wrote, Christ died for us. His death has washed away our sins, and that by dying, he defeated death itself. Don't you want that for yourself? I know I do. I want to be forgiven. I want my sin to be washed away. I want life, not death. And so I choose Christ, my God, who died upon a cross, for me. For me.